Felicity Brennan with algplanet.com with another installment of our original Women of Algae series. Today, I'm speaking with Dr. Flower Masuya, who is working with coastal communities in Zanzibar, Tanzania. Dr. Masuya is the chairperson and facilitator at the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative, where she works with villagers studying climate change, modifying farming methods, and adding value to seaweed. She earned her PhD in seaweed integrated aquaculture from Tel Aviv University in 2004. Her focus currently is on the socioeconomic, environmental, and women's health impacts of seaweed farming. Dr. Masuya, thank you so much for being with us today.
I'm glad to be here.
Now, I read that when you established the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative, which included the possibility for greater seaweed cultivation, everyone, including the government, thought you were crazy. Why did they think that?
You know, there's one thing about the people's mind, you know. The people's mind, the people's culture, what they are used to. So when I was starting the Seaweed Cluster Initiative, I was doing one-on-one meetings to talk to people that I knew, government people, colleagues, whoever. So I was telling the people that our seaweed that we are planting can be used to make some products, like soap, like, you know, cosmetics. And they were like, what? And then I said, seaweed can be eaten. This seaweed that we are planting here can be eaten. We can eat the seaweed. We can make food products. So definitely, because it's not traditional to eat seaweed here, it's not traditional to make seaweed products, and there was no seaweed product or no one eating seaweed, then they thought that maybe I was crazy talking about using seaweed for making cosmetic products, food products, and eating seaweed. That's what happened.
So it was completely outside of the culture, the existing culture.
It was completely outside the culture, because no one was using any seaweed in Tanzania. It was being planted and shipped abroad. It was a commercial crop and no one was using. Actually, there was one man in one village when I was talking about seaweed, and you know, he looked at me on the face and said, look here, lady, don't I have food? Why should I eat seaweed? I have food, you know. So people really, it was something very new to them, and they didn't understand what I was talking about.
So tell us some of the largest shifts you've seen since those early days.
Yes, I've seen really large shifts, because from that time when people were thinking that I am crazy to talk about eating seaweed. First there is what we started in the Seaweed Cluster Initiative, getting some funding from some organizations. We have a seaweed day, the seaweed day of the Seaweed Cluster Initiative, every 23rd July each year since 2016. So in this seaweed day, we would bring these small scale processors. They would bring their cosmetic products. They would bring their food products. But there are also some food products that are made on site. So like it's seaweed salad, like it's cooking seaweed as vegetable, all these are done on site. So when people come there and then they see, and then we give them maybe a piece of bread, you tell them, put the cooked seaweed in here, or put salad. You know, when they eat, it's like you wonder why people can eat seaweed. And for now in Tanzania, we have more than 28 groups of small scale processors who are now making seaweed products, marketing seaweed products. Some of them are farmers who are farming and at the same time making seaweed products. But there are those who are not farmers. They had nothing to do with seaweed. But after seeing that They can make seaweed products. They can sell. They can eat seaweed. Now they buy seaweed from the farmers and they use it at home. They make products. They sell in exhibitions. If nowadays you go to the, for example, there's this large exhibition called Sabasaba in Tanzania. It is international trade fair. Buying seaweed almost four or five stalls, booths where seaweed products are kept. So to me, this is a really big change. And those who are making the products now, they are not only from Zanzibar, because most of the seaweed is farmed in Zanzibar, but there are people from the mainland. There are people who are even not along the coast, but they are buying seaweed from the farmers from the coast, and they are cooking seaweed at home. They are making seaweed products and selling or buying directly from the coast, the people in the coast. So to me, this is really a huge, huge change in my country.
That's an incredibly huge change. And I understand that there's been a big shift in the role of women as well since you've started this. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Yes, the shift in the women's day, women's role has really changed very, very dramatically. Of course, we can say that when the women started to farm seaweed in 1989, when we started, it changed the culture because it started in Zanzibar, and of course it is farmed along the coast. And in Zanzibar, the culture is that the women stay at home. Some of them didn't even go to the market. Mm-hmm. So when seaweed farming came, the women left the houses and they went to farm seaweed. So this was a big cultural change. But then a woman to make a product out of the seaweed that they are farming, and then take this product to an exhibition, whether in Tanzania or in neighboring countries, Burundi, Kenya, Rwanda, Uganda, this is something that is so new to the women. So now women are seen as people who can involve in business, they can get money, they can be part of the family economics. So women now have money power. Women have a different status in the communities. The communities now see women as part of the breadwinners of the family. They see the women that they can bring food home, they can bring money home to help with the home economics. The society now is looking at these women in a different way, like a different kind of citizens. And some of the women actually nowadays have become leaders. They are selected even by the local governments to be leaders of the community. This is because they see the way the women are working hard and are advancing in the seaweed game.
Did you have an understanding originally when you set out to do this that this would help transform the station of women? Or were you just trying to bring seaweed cultivation more into the world and in those coastal communities?
When I started working into the seaweed industry, actually I started as a researcher doing research in seaweed farming, and especially because I did my undergraduate in botany and my PhD is purely on seaweed, integrated seaweed. So I was working with seaweed as a researcher at the beginning. When I was working, I saw that every time I go to do research, I was working with the farmers, setting experiments with them, involving them in the experiment throughout. So, and then I saw this same product that I'm doing research on is something that can help the farmers more than what they are doing now. So I said, my ambition now will be to use my research to help these women, these farmers advance in the seaweed industry. So that's when I brought this innovation into farming methods and value addition, so that this product they are making will take them further in their economics and in their livelihoods and social life in general.
Now I'm curious, you mentioned earlier that there are land farmers who are now buying products and making products inland. And I'm wondering what kind of economic impacts from the cultivation and creation of these products have you seen in the overall economy of Tanzania? Has that been documented?
For the whole of Tanzania, because Tanzania is a big country.
Yeah.
We have, all attractions, we have mountains, Mount Kilimanjaro, we have national parks. So the impact in the whole of Tanzania is not as big as it can be seen. But if you talk of economics of Zanzibar,
yeah. Okay,
Zanzibar, in the Zanzibar Islands, which are part of Tanzania, now seaweed industry contributes 7.6% of GDP. So to the Zanzibar Islands, this is a very big contribution. And I would say this has been contributed by value addition, because farming, yes, farming has been there. We have climate change, which is affecting the higher value seaweed and the seaweed farming in general. But with innovative farming methods, farming the deep water areas to produce the higher value seaweed, and especially adding value, making seaweed products that are sold, you know, everywhere in the country and in other African countries. This has contributed a lot in the economics of the Zanzibar Island.
And you just mentioned climate change, and I'm wondering, what are those major threats of climate change, and how are the communities responding to that?
Climate change, what is observed everywhere is that the surface water temperatures in the ocean are increasing. So for seaweed that is farmed in the shallow water areas, it has problems. The seaweed, Capaficus or cotoni, that one cannot tolerate high temperatures. What we are seeing in our intertidal areas is temperatures going above 37, 38 degrees Celsius. To Capaficus, that is a problem. And we know that Capaficus is a higher value seaweed. It has a price that is double that of Yukuma. Capaficus is sold at 80 cents of a dollar per kilo of dry seaweed, and the Yukuma is sold by only 40 cents. But our people can no longer farm this higher value seaweed. So there are two issues here, that they are now have to farm seaweed, which means their income is minimum. So that's why we add value to the lower value seaweed, so they can make seaweed products. And now, what we're trying to do is our farmers now know that they need to move the farms into deeper water areas where temperatures are cooler, where conditions are more stable. And they are even affected sometimes within the farming itself, because for those who have not gone into the deep water areas, because you know we have challenges of going into deep water areas, learning how to swim, acquiring boats. So when it reaches the hot season between December and February, some of them just stop to farm. They wait for the rain to come in March so that the ocean will be cooler. So people are getting affected very much by climate change, because what we see, they are diseases and pests. We see this ice where the seaweed is bleached and it just disintegrates, and the farmers lose all the biomass. And we see the epiphytes that attach on the surface of the seaweed, hindering photosynthesis, causing wounds that bacteria can come and infect the seaweed. So the farmers are losing they are losing the biomass because of these things that are caused by climate change. So that's why we are really trying to develop technologies to farm and also to add value, so that during the good seasons, they will farm a lot of the higher value seaweed. And this requires actually good seed for the farmers to continue farming the higher value seaweed.
Now, I know when I spoke with Dr. Lim and Dr. Hurtado, they were talking, they're doing some research on identifying some Capaficus that can exist in warmer waters. And is that something you all would be interested in? Obviously, it seems like you would benefit from that. They can find a strain in their research that can tolerate that warmer water.
You know, one good thing with the seaweed that we are producing commercially, we imported the strains from Philippines. So it means that if they find another strain, that is very good for us. And in our case, we are also trying something like that because, you know, Professor Lim, Dr. Hurtado, we were working the Global Seaweed Star Project. So as part of the Global Seaweed Star Project, we were looking for how to get seed for how to get more resistant variety. So even in Tanzania, we have been going to the field to look for native varieties of the Yukuma and Kappa ficus. We have now a PhD student who was working with the Global Seaweed Star. He is continuing. So we have actually collected some native varieties of the two seaweeds and tried to cultivate them in the nursery farms. The aim is to get to propagate enough biomass to see if this can be used by the farmers. So if we get a combination of what we are doing in Tanzania and what our colleagues are doing in Malaysia and the Philippines, that would be the best because we can all share our seedlings and the seed for advancing the seaweed industry. My vision for the next 5 years is to see that this climate change impact is not affecting our farmers as much as it is affecting them now. I would want to see the deep water farming technologies developed, some more developed, and those that are already developed, they are applied by the farmers. So involvement of the government, private sector, academia, and everyone who is a stakeholder in the seaweed industry to make sure that we implement and we develop technologies to farm our seaweed in the deep waters so that our farmers will farm the high value seaweed. So I would want to see these technologies and our people producing the higher value seaweed. At the same time, I would want to see, because the seaweed value added products that our processors are producing for now, they still have limited market because they are sold to tourists, so they're taken to the exhibitions. So involvement of the government, NGOs, stakeholders to expand the market so that more and more products can be produced in higher quantities and then sold everywhere in Tanzania, in Africa, in the whole world. This is what I want to see in the next few years.
So basically build resistance and develop distribution networks that reach a global audience.
Yes, that is very true. And to make sure as much as possible that the resilience of our farmers is maintained. Our farmers continue to be resilient, they continue in the seaweed industry so that they can link with those abroad. We are already linking with the Philippines, you know, Malaysia. We have colleagues in other countries. So we need to really link and all our farmers can actually have exchange visits and they can have, online conversations and all things so that together we can pull the seaweed industry ahead.
Yeah.
And overcome all many of these challenges and just try to move forward, not backward.
You've had such a huge influence there. It's really beautiful and inspiring to see. I'm a little overwhelmed by the power of what one person can do for entire communities. It's so beautiful, Flower. Thank you for everything you're doing. Is there anything else you would like to share with our viewers?
I would just like to share with the viewers that bringing something new to the community is possible. Using a product that you are making is so satisfying, feel good. So they can follow our seaweed cluster website, www.seaweedcluster.or.tz in Tanzania. So that they can see what we are doing. And I welcome anyone who can travel person or whatever to come join us on 23rd July for our civil day, if possible. So that they can see what we are doing here and how we are using our seaweed. Thank you.
Thank you for all that you do. And thank you for being with us today on algaeplanet.com.